Let's start with, well, of course, you were agriculture chief of President Duterte. You are running with Ping Lacson and Tito Soto, and you do have questions coming from different sectors. Why weren't you adopted, for example, even by the PDP Laban faction, or even by the Marcos Sara camp, considering you served President Duterte?
Well, it's something that should not come. The answer should not come from me, actually. It should come from them. I believe I only have to belong to one party to be able to, you know, wage a campaign in these elections. I do not see the reason behind any desire to belong to so many parties, because in the first place, you have to believe in the party platform. How can you possibly join several parties and you know, campaign on a specific platform? So I don't believe in, of course, the idea of being endorsed by groups and by people and being adopted. Of course, is a political plus, you know? But I don't see a need for it, in as far as I'm concerned, because I have a very specific advocacy, actually, it's agriculture.
Okay, and, Manny, yes. Before you go with the advocacy for agriculture, we'll get to that in detail. I'm curious, are you seeking President Duterte's endorsement, or has he endorsed you already?
He once mentioned during an event in Davao that he was endorsing me along with several others. I did not seek it, and I don't think I should seek it. It is not mine to ask, it is his to give. So any endorsement should come from those who would like to endorse me. I'm not going to ask for it.
Okay. Now, let's face it. No, you were one of the first choices of the president when he came into office. Did you have any kind of a fallout? You did resign in, I believe it was June 2019, when there was a perceived lack. How is your relationship with the president today?
Well, he's still a personal friend of mine. That's something that I could not deny. He's the only godfather to my son. And that's a personal relationship that I will, of course, treasure. Now, I have no falling out with the president, but I had a falling out with the economic managers led by Secretary Carlos Dominguez, who obviously has the ear of the president, even on matters that concerned my department, agriculture. And one of the very critical issues that placed me at odds with the economic managers, actually, was the policy on massive importation as a way of addressing inflation. Because to me, that's destructive to Philippine agriculture. We could import what we need, but I don't believe that we should import more than what we need. And the proverbial straw that broke the camel's back, actually, was the rice tariffication law. Because I had warned early on that the flooding of the market with rice and the emasculation of the National Food Authority to the point of it being relegated just as a mere buffer stocking agency would be detrimental to a very critical industry, which means food for the Filipino people. And I was proven right, because early on, the economic managers, in proposing to the president and the Senate the rice tariffication law, they promised that the price of rice in the market would go down by as much as 7 pesos per kilo. That did not happen. In fact, it went up. Also, they said that the tariff to be collected from the RTL could boost the productivity of the Filipino farmers and improve their lives. That's not what happened. In fact, the rice farmers are suffering right now, and there's a double whammy. With the price of fertilizer going up, life is more miserable for the Filipino rice farmers of the moment.
Okay, so if you are telling us that number one, the major reason is you had a disagreement in terms of policy when it came with the economic manager, specifically Secretary Dominguez, last Saturday you had a public post. And in your public post, you claim that the Philippines achieved its highest growth in agriculture in over half a century since 2017. You even praised the Duterte presidency for its growth coming from agriculture. Is that correct?
Yes, it is. In fact, we achieved the highest growth for agriculture in 2017, 3.9%, almost 4%. That's the highest in so many decades. And while we were battered by typhoons the following year, it was still a positive 1% growth for Philippine agriculture. Right now, it's in the negative. And I attribute that growth to a combination of so many factors. The climatic conditions were ideal. The campaign of the Department of Agriculture to use hybrid seeds for rice was accepted by the farmers,
Are you saying that during the time you were agriculture secretary, that's when the Philippines was highest performing in terms of agri?
Yes.
Because you resigned in 2019. Is that correct?
No, I'm sorry. That's 2017 and 2018.
That's why. 2017. So you are saying that during the time that you were agriculture secretary, agri was at its highest performing.
That's what the Philippine Statistics Authority said. It's not mine.
So, Manny, I wanted to correct you on that because the numbers I have, for example, is the agricultural sector only grew by an average of 1.6% in 2017 to 2020. Of course, this is until 2020, and that's only half of the 3% average annual growth recorded in the past 16 years. In 2018, you were still agriculture secretary, the growth was only 0.56%. So you do have sectors questioning your performance too.
Yeah, of course, that's a given, Karen. Nobody is going to be contented with what I'm doing. I was doing. But I don't know where you got that figure because the 3.9 actually was reported officially by the Philippine Statistics Office. We only quoted that number from that report made by PSA. Mm-hmm. And maybe you're right about the 0.56, but it's still a positive growth. And compare that now to the performance of the agriculture department. It's in the negative. I'm not saying that I'm better. Maybe the conditions were just better when I was Secretary of Agriculture. And maybe we were just pushing the right buttons during the period I was Secretary of Agriculture. But what could not be denied is the fact that right after the rice tariffication law was implemented, the lives of the Filipino rice farmers actually went from where they were in 2018 to where they are right now, suffering from the high cost of inputs and at the same time suffering from the very low price at the farm gate.
Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. So if you win as senator, the repeal of the rice tariffication law, would this be your first priority?
Actually, Karen, I have already prepared what I wanted to do. I'm not saying that I'm gonna win this election, but I'm prepared. Meaning I'm going to war with the complete array of armaments that I would like to use when I get there. And I have divided my legislative agenda actually into urgent legislative measures and the institutional measures. Urgent would include the immediate rice tariff amendment of the rice tariffication law, which is now supported by my standard bearers in Santa Rosa and Nueva Ecija. Senator Ping Lacson, our standard bearer for the presidency, and Senate President Tito Soto, our standard bearer for the vice presidency, supported my position that the RTL should be reviewed.
Yeah. So what amendment would you propose for the rice tariffication law, not the complete repeal?
Well, number one, we have to bring back the NFA into the picture. We cannot allow the private sector to control the rice industry. You know, Karen, what the economic managers fail to appreciate and realize is that the rice industry in this country is controlled by the rice cartel, a big business. So when they opened up the market free for all to everybody, the rice importers actually were making a heyday. They imported rice, which is classified as premium. That's why hindi pumaba yung presyo ng bigas sa mercado, because what they were selling was jasmine rice, basmati, long grains. The original intention of the RTL was to bring down the price of rice in the market to a level affordable to the consumers. That was the intention. That was what they promised the president, actually. And ang sabi pa nila, yung tariff na makukolekta from the RTL would be given to the farmers and they would be able to boost their productivity. Yeah. That also did not happen because mali-mali yung paghati-hati ng pondo. Yung 10 billion actually is allocated to programs which I believe do not really focus on increasing productivity. 10 billion, 5 billion for mechanization, that's wrong. While of course farmers need machinery, they don't consider it as the most important factor in increasing the productivity. One would be irrigation, the other would be fertilization, good seeds, and of course the good price for their produce. Those are the factors that would improve productivity. So yun yung mga babaguhin natin, yung allocation ng pondo, yung pagbabalik ng NFA para ma-supervise ang rice industry. Sapagkat right now, pati yung NFA wala nang power to even inspect warehouses which are suspected to be hoarding rice. So yan yung naging problema natin, and isa yan sa mga immediate legislations. The other would be reforming our market system. I really believe that because of the fact that we are a geographically fragmented country, government must be involved in the distribution and repositioning of food supplies. Napakamura ng isa sa tawi-tawi, pero sinong kukuha doon para dalhin sa Metro Manila? Government must come in, and I'm proposing the expansion of the mandate of the Food Terminal Incorporated, establishing regional food centers where farmers and fishermen will just deliver their products, and FDI will be assigned with the task of repositioning this in the big cities, opening up outlets in Metro Manila, Cebu, and so on and so forth, para yung pag-distribute ng pagkain ay mapapadali at sariwa yung darating sa atin. Our problem in this country actually is not the lack of food, but the very poor positioning of food. The third immediate advocacy that I would like to introduce in the Senate is the review of these pro-importation policies by government, lowering tariff at the expense of the local producers. Now, for institutional reforms, I am going back to the forest. You know, we are left with 6% of our forest over as of the last 10 years, you know. So we have to protect the forest because it is where the water comes from. And without water, we won't have agriculture. I also will advocate for the establishment of a national water conservation and management authority. We have to manage our water resources. Sapagkat tayo lang yung bansa na binabaha, nalulunod tayo sa baha, pero tatlong buwan na walang ulan, natitigang na yung ating mga lupa because we have not actually built dams. And now this idea actually is supported by Governor Rolito Albano of Isabela. Sabi niya 21 yung tributaries ng Cagayan River. Kaya bumabaha dahil walang mga water impounding or dams. And by building dams, you conserve your water. You could come up with hydroelectric power generation. And you could actually come up with the water supply for your population centers.
Okay,
the other would Manny, be the opening, yes.
No, I'm curious, do you have to be in the Senate for these great ideas? Clearly, these are the ideas. I mean, they are important and I see the value in them. But is the Senate the perfect place for these
ideas? It is.
Or shouldn't you?
Because you have to legislate laws, Karen, to be able to create an authority that will handle your national water management and conservation program, you have to create an authority which would bring together the different agencies involved in this. To be able to protect the forest, hindi pwedeng DNR na lang. Uh-oh. It should be a whole of nation approach, and you need an authority that would handle that. This is an urgent matter, Karen. This is life and death for Philippine agriculture, actually.
I'm curious, Manny, what made you decide to run for the Senate instead of the lower house when the budget process starts from the lower house?
Well, I have seen with my own two eyes, and I have actually witnessed it, yung power ng Senate, actually. The power of the Senate to craft laws and directions. If I were to run for Congress, I would only be one of the 300 voices or so. If I take a Senate seat, I will be one of the 24 who will be listened to by the president, the vice president, and all the policymakers of government. And it is in the Senate actually where meaningful and very critical legislations are crafted and introduced.
All right, Manny, let's be honest. What was the most difficult or challenging being part of the Duterte administration? I mean, of course, your friends.
As far as agriculture is concerned?
Yeah. Okay. Because clearly there was something because you resigned. So there was something there that made it difficult.
My greatest regret actually, Karen, is that I failed to convince the economic managers that the Philippines could be food sufficient. And that's one of my greatest regrets actually. They did not believe me. In fact, they ridiculed me. At ang tinawag pa akong mahangin kasi sinasabi kong we can be rice sufficient. We can be food sufficient because simple naman ang aking comparative story. Look, Israel 2.2 million hectares lang, 60% desert, limang ilog. Ang ulan nila is 360 millimeters, yung kanilang rainfall. Tayo 30 million hectares, we have the fifth longest coastline in the world at 36,289 kilometers. We have over 200 big rivers and lakes. We have fertile soil. We have so much resources, but Israel exports, we import. And it's in the policy. Because long before, Israel had already considered food security as part of their national security strategy. Sa atin dito, tamad tayo mag-isip eh. Pag medyo kinakapos tayo sa baboy, import na lang, mas madali. Pag kinakapos tayo sa isda, import na lang. Instead of developing our fisheries, instead of supporting our local hog raisers and poultry raisers, we opt for the quick fix. And that's our problem because this has been my problem in dealing with economic managers actually. And not only with them, no, nothing personal, Karen. It's a question actually of the eternal conflict between the economists and the agriculturists. The economists would always be concerned with inflation numbers. The agriculturists would think about food supply not only for tomorrow or next month, but for the next generation. And that's how I think. Kaya nung nasa cabinet meeting kami, pinapaliwanag ko sa kabinete at kay Pangulong Duterte, sabi ko, ang isang bagay na gusto ko maintindihan nyo, the things that we're doing right now in agriculture, the reforms that we're doing, may not even bear fruit during the administration of the president. But it's something that we have to do because agriculture, food security is intergenerational. It's not about the political term of the president. But this is sadly one of my failures. I don't know where I went wrong. Maybe I did not communicate my ideas very clearly. Maybe I had a very poor convincing power. But they ridiculed me and they laughed at me. At ang tawag sa akin, mahangin. Kasi daw sinasabi kong maging rice sufficient ang Pilipinas. Wala naman daw area. Hey, look, they don't know what they're talking about. Irrigation, for example. Only half of the rice farms in the Philippines right now is irrigated. Mm-hmm. How do you achieve rice sufficiency when one half of your rice farm could only produce once a year? So you have to work on irrigation and you need money to do that. Number two, we have to wean ourselves from this dependence on importation. Ang sabi kasi ng ibang, yung Singapore, nag-i-import, buhay naman. We cannot compare the Philippines to Singapore because of our comparative advantage of having the vast lands, the long coastline, the good rainfall pattern, and very industrious Filipino farmers. All that we need to do is encourage them.
Yeah. I'm curious, Manny, two things. It's the first time you shared about this cabinet meeting na pinagtawanan ka, tinawag kang mahangin. Would you say this was the tipping point to you resigning?
Yes, it was.
Because you didn't really speak. When you resigned, I remember we were trying to get you on Head Start for an interview and you kept silent. Nobody really knew from your end the reason why you resigned. So was this the tipping point?
It was a tipping point actually. Ang punto ko, kung hindi ako susuportahan, I will fail. And if, because naging parang malalim na yung hidwaan namin ni Secretary Dominguez eh. In fact, nagtalo kami sa harapan ni Presidente, nagkasagutan kami, and he never forgave me for that, no? Because ang
aura kasi... He never forgave you? The President never forgave you or Dominguez?
No, Dominguez.
Okay.
Dominguez. Siyempre, siya yung malapit sa Presidente. So they kept on telling the President that I was incompetent, that I would bring down the popularity of the President towards the end of his term. And so, you know, I'm a friend of the president. I don't want to put him in a difficult situation. So sabi ko, kung ganyan ang pananaw niyo sa akin, I better resign. So I was asked by the president to move over to Minda. Yeah. And remember, Karen, I submitted my resignation June 26 of 2019. Yes. I was replaced August 5, 2019. It took the president 41 days to decide who would be my replacement. So yung issue na resignation ko, actually, it was a voluntary resignation. It was a courtesy resignation. It was a resignation designed to save the sector that I represented from further punishment by the economic managers who were not giving us the sufficient budget, even with the pronouncement of the president, na i-increase yung budget ng agriculture. Look, I was only receiving 50 billion when I was Secretary of Agriculture. Today, they have given the Department of Agriculture over 100 billion as budget. So ang aking punto, rather than bring down the Department of Agriculture with me because of my my odds with the economic managers, I would rather save my sector and resign. And I actually pinatawag ko yung mga representante ng agriculture sector, fisheries sector, before I resigned, sila Raul Montemayor, and I told them, I told you from the very beginning that when the time comes that I will not be able to protect the sector anymore, I will resign. The time has come, so I will resign. Yun ang kwento doon, Karen. I have nothing, I feel no ill feelings against the president. In fact, I wanted to save him from a very compromising situation of me and Dominguez, you know, at feud. No? And him placed in a very tight situation.
Now, you know, Manny, the president will be out of office in a few months, right? And I wanted to ask you if there was one thing that you feel the president could have done better. I mean, do you feel that there was a lack of wisdom on who he would listen to? I mean, many presidents have different issues. You knew him, you were quite close to Duterte. What do you believe was, I guess, a weak spot in his decision making?
You know, the president will always listen to a group position. Like say for example, rice clarification. Bakit pinakinggan niya ng presidente si Dominguez at saka economic managers over me? Because I was alone. And I was up against the economic managers. And you know, they actually misled the president. Because ang sabi nila, Mr. President, it's a no-brainer. Ito yung language ni Dominguez. It's a no-brainer. 105 million consumers against 5 million farmers. The numbers are not even right because yung farmers hindi lang 5 million, it's more than 5 million actually, you know. Now, sabi nila, if you sign this bill into law, the price of rice in the market will go down, inflation will go down, and yung tariff na makokolekta natin sa importation ng bigas will be given to the rice farmers so that we'll be able to boost their production. Maski ikaw ang presidente, Karen, ganun ang presentation. Ganun ang explanation sa iyo. Even the Senate was convinced. In fact, unanimous yung approval ng Senate ng rice tariffication law because that was the presentation. Maski ako ang presidente at that time, with that presentation, I will agree. I will not listen to my agriculture secretary because here is a very good explanation, a very beautiful scenario of what's gonna happen if I support this position. So yun ang si presidente kasi I've known him since I was governor, and isang ugali niya is kapag nakapag-decide na siya, huwag mo na siyang gabalain. Yun ang isang ugali niya. And I respect that, no. So nung mag-decide siya na paburan yung economic managers, medyo nagkaroon na ako ng kaba sa sarili ko. If my president doesn't listen to me anymore, I don't think there is any reason for me to stay any longer in the department that I represent.
And you would say, I mean, even if it was voted unanimously, that now we are reaping the mistakes. I mean, clearly, the irony of all of this is, well, it's more expensive now to actually plant and produce rice per hectare, and that's a fact. And number two, yes, the price of rice went down in the market, but
no,
then
I disagree.
Go ahead.
I disagree with you. I go to the market, Karen. Nawala na yung presyong 27 na bigas. Nawala na yung 30 bigas. Ang pinakamababang bigas ngayon nasa 38-40. This was already very high during my time. Umaabot pa nga ng 60 pesos yung mga imported na jasmine rice.
So what you're saying is actually the private sector actually, instead of spurring competition and lowering the prices, ended up controlling the prices instead.
Yes, that's what happened, because the rice industry in the Philippines is controlled by the rice cartel. And when they started enjoying the huge profits from the importation of premium rice, they decided to negate the market to the palay produced by the local farmers, to the point that farmers are forced to sell their produce at prices as low as 10 pesos, 12 pesos. I was in Bicol about 45 days ago, and I was told that during the rainy season, the price of the farm gate price of their palay would go to as low as 8 pesos per kilo. Pag ganyan, talagang patay yung rice farmers natin.
All right. Now, the irony is, of course, your candidates you support fully, Senator Ping Lacson and Senate President Tito Soto, is you just said they are open to an amendment of the rice tarification law, correct?
Yes. In fact, this is one of...
But then it is only, the irony is, it's only Bongbong Marcos among the candidates who's completely against the rice tarification law. I've heard him in a forum, and he's actually against it. That's the irony of it all.
But that's an afterthought, actually, against it, because it has been proven that it has very bad effects on the rice industry and the rice farmers as well. In hindsight, if you consider the situation where the senators were in at the time the bill was introduced to them, napakaganda ng projection. Can you imagine? Sinong hindi makukumbinsi? Bababa ng 7 piso yung presyo ng kilo ng bigas sa merkado. Gaganda ang buhay ng mga rice farmers. Sino hindi makukumbinsi? In hindsight, kung maski ako nandun, kung ganoon ang presentation at hindi ko naintindihan masyado yung agriculture at saka yung reality sa rice industry, I would support that bill as it was presented to us. No? In fact, unanimous ka eh. Unanimous. Pero ngayon, nakita nila na tama yung sinasabi ko na huwag nating bitawan yung rice industry. Kasi ang cartel has been controlling the rice industry for so long. Kaya nagpiesta yung rice cartel nung tinanggalan nila ng powers to regulate and to supervise yung National Food Authority.
Okay. Manny, I'm curious, since the president has a few months to go and you can assess, you've been in the cabinet, other than Senator Bongo, who has the president's ear? Is it really Secretary Dominguez?
Well, for economic matters, yes. For economic matters, yes.
Just
other matters. And of course, there's Bingbong Ijaldia, a loyal friend of the president. No? Ito yung mga pinapakinggan niya.
Uh-oh.
And go ahead.
But would you say that setup was, contributed to certain failures of his administration?
You know, if you ask me about failures, ano bang administration ang walang failures? Lahat may failures. But I would rather look at the positive achievements of this administration rather than harp on what had not been done. No? And I refer, kasi tinatanong nila ako eh, ano daw ang pinakamalaking achievement ni Rodrigo Duterte as president? Ako, if you ask me, peace in Mindanao. That's his greatest legacy, actually. No president in recent history has handled that problem so well that in just a few months he was able to convince the MILF to agree to his terms. No? And nawala yung, you know, remember, Karen, I was in the thick of this issue. I was the one who filed the opposition sa Supreme Court sa MOA AD ni President Arroyo.
Yeah.
You remember that? 2008.
Yeah.
At that time, yung pag-handle nila ng, and I mean no disrespect, ang pag-handle nila ng peace negotiations with the MILF was through the peace panels. So may panel ang gobyerno, may panel ang MILF. At alam mo naman, kapag ganun ang negotiation, pati yung lahat ng kataga doon sa statement na bibitawan nila, ini-examine yan ano ang implication. No? So they went to as far as Jakarta, Indonesia, talking about peace. When President Duterte took over, I saw him personally summoning Kagi Murad, who is now known as Chief Minister Ahud Murad Ibrahim, no? To his office in Davao. And I saw them talk silang dalawa lang. So he handled it personally. And to me, that's a mark of a true leader na talagang kaya niyang i-handle yung mga difficult situation. Now, for me, this is his greatest legacy. Because with this now, people can move around Mindanao freely. We can develop the Bangsamoro area, which is a potential agri-fisheries production area. Mm-hmm. Did you know that Barm actually is the number one fish producer in the country? At magulo pa yan, ha? Lalo na kaya kung magkakaroon ng talagang lasting peace in that region. So I'm fully supportive of this initiative by the president. In fact, that was one of the reasons why he assigned me as the point person for the BARM when I was assigned as the chairman after my stint as DA secretary. And that, Karen, I'm a very positive person. I look at achievements rather than failures. And I believe that for all of the things that President Duterte failed to do, baliwala yan in as far as the things that he was able to do comparatively, you know, is concerned.
Okay, let's talk about the latest survey, the possibility of you winning. I'm holding right now the latest Pulse Asia survey. And in this survey, you have an awareness of 40%, right? Okay, I'm sure you're familiar with this. And you are number 31 to 36. Is this correct, Manny?
Yes, it is. That's the survey. But after this interview today, I expect to be able to go up to the top 20.
Hindi, ang tanong kasi dito, eto ka, di ba? May kakayanan ka, kaya mo, may plano ka, may karanasan ka, pero number 31 to 36 ka sa survey.
Awareness, yes.
Oh, so...
Hindi preferential, awareness.
No, your ranking is 31 to 36.
That's awareness, not okay. Preference.
All right.
Okay.
But the voting for is you are at 4.4%.
Yeah.
Okay. But let's move forward. Is you're not even in the strongest ticket today, right? So, ang tanong dito is, anong plano mo, Manny?
Well, I'm just moving around telling people what I intend to do. If they like what I tell them I would like to do for Philippine agriculture. You know, I believe in patriotism, Karen. I'm a Filipino citizen and I believe I could help this country. I'm offering myself. If the Filipino people will not accept my offer, thank you. I go back to my farm, a happy farmer. No hurt feelings. At least ginawa ko yung aking tungkulin bilang isang Pilipinong mamamayan. Offering myself in the service of the country because I believe I could do something. But if my ideas are not do not resonate well with the voters, I'm not gonna lose a finger, actually.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna lose
it. But does it frustrate you that popularity and name recall, regardless of track record, is the name of the game? I mean, in the top 12, you do have, you have Jinggoy Estrada that's hitting 9 to 11. Despite the accusations against him and what he's faced in court, you have Robin Padilla at 11 to 13, despite having no experience in governance. I mean, this is not to belittle any particular candidate. This is just a matter of perspective. Does that frustrate you?
No, it's part of democracy. It's, you know, it's part of the election process. And unless we change the system, kasi ang problema natin, centralized yung ating political system. We have been long advocating for regional distribution of Senate representation, actually, to the point of promoting federalism as a way of achieving that. But since hindi natin nagawa yun, actually talaga, kung iisipin mo, lugi talaga kaming mga probinsyano because number one, even if maganda yung programa namin, magandang intention namin, kulang kami sa exposure sa media, kulang kami sa banggit sa showbiz, hindi kami marunong kumanta at sumayaw. So,
pero
lugi kami. But,
mas malala pa ngayon, pinasara pa ang ABS-CBN. Pag nanalo ba kayo, sir, sa Senado, susuportahan nyo ang pagbubukas?
I will have to look into that. No, I mean, let's take a look at why ABS-CBN was ordered closed. No? Is it because of press freedom, or is it because of violations of the law? No? And I cannot say outright, because I've not really looked into it. No? But what I can promise you is I will seriously look into it. No?
Okay, but do you agree with the closure? I mean, clearly prompted and initiated.
Karen, my point is this, no? There should have been a reason for them to close ABS-CBN. Possibling my violations, possibling sa franchise. But I'd like to look into it, because you have to remember, I'm a journalist. By heart, no? I'm a journalist. I believe in press freedom. So kung ang issue lang is press freedom, I'm with you. Pero kung may violation sa franchise or sa business activities, then that's another story. That's why the best thing that I could promise you, in as far as ABS-CBN issue is concerned, is I will seriously look into it. And if it signifies the muzzling of press freedom, then I am for you. But if it means you violated corporate laws or franchise or the provisions of your franchise, then that's another story.
Okay, but let's move on from that issue, because we can't make this interview about ABS-CBN. But I wanted to ask you, would you take another post in agriculture? If, let's say you don't win, but then you are offered to be agriculture secretary again.
No, I'm not gonna go there anymore. Nakita ko, Karen, maski secretary ka, hindi ganon ka absolute yung power mo to institute reforms. Eh. Hmm. You have to contend with the policies, the laws. No? Yun yung mga parameters mo. Eh. This was my problem, actually. Look, say for example, yung bureaucracy kasi napakabagal tumanggap ng mga bagong ideas. When I introduced the solar-powered irrigation system, along with it was the proposal to buy drilling trucks, drilling rigs, so that we could drill for the solar irrigation. Sabi ng DBM, hey, tika muna, wala sa menu yan. That's not in your menu. You cannot buy drilling rigs. You're only supposed to buy only tractors and so on and so forth. No? It took us about, 2 years to convince them na kailangan to for an innovation in irrigation. Like, say, for example, yung paggamit, for example, ng hybrid seeds for rice. Did you know that the RTL actually defines the areas where hybrid rice could only be introduced under the program? So ito yung mga bagay-bagay na nakita ko, no? Na tingin ko, maski secretary ka, kung hindi mabago yung policies, yung mindset, yung legislations, then there's nothing much you can do. You will just be subservient to whatever your president tells you, or you'll be confined to the parameters set by the existing policies and the laws.
Oo. Manny, is it enough to say nagkamali ang Pangulong Duterte when it comes to some agri policies?
Well, kung nagkamali man ang presidente, it was in good faith. It was because the economic managers who were supposed to give him sound advice on these very critical matters misled him. No? And I don't blame him. Maski ako, sabi ko nga sa'yo kanina, kung ako man ang binigyan ng ganung presentation na, Mr. President, itong mangyayari, maganda to, bababa yung presyo ng bigas, gaganda yung buhay ng rice farmers. Maski akong presidente, papayag ako. No? So it's not his fault, actually. Actually, he was misled. And if there's anybody who should be blamed for this, it should be the economic managers, who I believe did not really study the realities on the ground. No? Iba kasi yung theories, iba yung realities. Eh. And that's where I have a distinct advantage, Karen, because I move around, I talk to people, I feel the ground. No? And that's why I'm telling the Filipino voters, hey, you want a Senate that will serve as the heart and the conscience of the nation, I could represent you. Kung gusto niyo ng kantahan at kasayawan, eh, doon kayo. Ako, seryoso ako sa aking ino-offer. And ulitin ko, walang mawawala sa akin kung hindi ako manalo sa election na ito. Pero tingin ko, another 6 years na walang magtitimon ng redirection ng Philippine agriculture, another 6 years of the same policies, dependence on importation, relegation of agriculture to ninth rank in the budget allocation, agriculture will suffer an irreversible damage.
Mm-mm. All right. Now, let me ask you some other issues, and you can answer yes, no, or with reservations and explain quickly. Are you for compulsory vaccination?
You know, I am vaccinated, nakaboost ako, but I believe in personal liberty.
Okay.
I mean, I should be the captain of my body.
Mm. Would you consider the drug war of the president a success or failure?
Success in as far as instilling fear in the hearts of the drug dealers and the drug drug lords is concerned, but there's a need to really review the participation of the police in some questionable operations.
Mm-mm. So naniniwala kayo nagkaroon ng EJK talaga sa drug war ng Pangulo?
I cannot make that judgment. It has got to be proven in court.
Mm. Okay, let's talk about foreign policy. Did this administration, would you consider it a success or failure in terms of how we've handled China and the West Philippine Sea?
You know, Karen, yung China engagement kasi napaka hirap i-handle niyan. No? Because early on, pag takeover ni President Duterte actually from President Noynoy Aquino, hirap yung Philippine agriculture. In fact, our agriculture products could hardly penetrate China. And I think this was in the back of the mind of the president when he engaged China. I'm not saying that the policies that he adopted are right, no? Pero yung epekto in as far as agriculture is concerned, and I will only talk about agriculture, positive yung pag-handle niya ng relasyon sa China in as far as agriculture is concerned. Because na-open up yung China market for our products, we were able to export a lot of our agriculture products to China. Now, for other fields, I'm not an expert in those areas.
Okay. Should the president release his statement of assets, liabilities, and net worth?
That is his decision to make.
But if should a president, a future president?
That is his decision to make. But if you ask me, I have long advocated that every public official should be like Cesar's wife, no? Cesar's wife, rather. Let's open up ourselves to the public. In fact, if you remember, Karen, I'm the only secretary in the cabinet of President Duterte who offered to submit himself to a lifestyle check by the PACC. And that is a distinction that I hold dear, no? Because pinakita ko na wala akong tinatago at wala akong ginawang kabulastugan as Secretary of Agriculture.
Okay. Now, the anti-dynasty bill, would you support... would you support a law that strengthens it, that actually makes it implementable?
You know, I'm not a lawyer, Karen, but there is something, a constitutional issue on the anti-dynasty law. Why? Every person has the right to suffrage, the right to be voted, and the right to vote. If you enforce the anti-dynasty law, which limits people in a family to run for an elected position, are you not depriving that person's right to vote and be voted upon? That's a constitutional issue and it has got to be settled, no? Hindi ko sinasabi yan dahil may mga kapatid ako sa politika, no? Sabi-sabi kami tumatakbo, no? But because I think it's an issue that is beyond yung bakit puro na lang kayo. Eh, pinipili ng tao. Like say for example, if one family decides to be doctors, all of them to be doctors, do we prevent them from doing that? What do we call that? Medical dynasty? If every family, if all of the family actually decides to be teachers, should we prevent that? What's that? Educational dynasty? Anyway, at the end of the day, it's the people who will elect. Yung pagdudoktor, decision ng pamilya yan. Pero yung pagiging gobernador o mayor, decision ng tao. So let's leave it to the people.
Uh-oh. Manny, is it time to already pass divorce?
Pardon?
Is it time to already pass divorce?
Divorce? I actually support that idea. Bakit natin pipilitin yung isa't isa kung hindi nila sa pwede magsama? And it's actually a an issue that has long been frowned upon by you know Catholics like me. I'm a Catholic, by the way, Karen. I'm a former seminarian. But yeah. I believe that we should all have freedom to lead our lives as we wish.
All right. On that note, Manny Piñol, thank you so much for joining me today. Is there anything you'd like to add very quickly before you go? You are number 52.
Yes. I believe, Karen, that the Philippines could be food sufficient. But we have to believe. We have to pass laws and legislations which would support our fisheries and agriculture. We have to really work on our comparative advantage. 30 million hectares, long coastline, good rainfall, good water sources. All that we need to do is believe that we could be a food sufficient country. In fact, even a food exporting country. Thank you.
All right. On that note, you take care, sir, and good luck to you.